Ham Radio Now, episode 234. EchoSounding. Wait a second. EchoSounding, the ionosphere with SDR from the DCC in Chicago, 2015. This is presented by Tom McDermott, N5EG. He's been on Ham Radio Now on the DCC before. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. So, EchoSounding, the ionosphere. Wait a minute. EchoSounding, the ionosphere. Yeah, never mind. Sorry, Tom. Don't you have to be NASA or something to do that? Well, turns out no. Not if you know what you're doing and you can assemble the relatively modest hardware that that Tom did. In a minute, he'll show you how after I make my usual pitch for you to stop by the hamradionow.tv website and click the pig. No Kickstarter this year. We tried, but missed the goal. So it's up to you to support me making videos of the DCC, and you know what to do. HamRadioNow.tv. So back to the DCC 2015 in Chicago. Here is Steve to introduce Tom.
All right, so let's make some introductions here. So we're happy to have Tom McDermott, N5EG, and his topic is EchoSounding the Ionosphere with SDR. Thank you.
Good morning. Back in the 1960s, I had a neighbor who was a ham. And I went over to his house occasionally. He liked to drag out his telescope and talk up and down the West Coast on 80 meters. And I asked him, isn't it a lot of work to drag out the telescope if the band's not open? And he said, let me show you something. And he would fire up his linear amplifier and his helicrafter's transmitter and his receiver and a scope. And he would send a string of dits at about a kilowatt output and look at the scope on his Super Pro receiver. And if the ionosphere was there that night, you could kind of see the ringing out of the signal. And I always thought that was pretty neat. So it kind of stuck with me for about 45 years or so. And I always had radios. They had turnaround times of 15 or 20 milliseconds. And none of that worked. I always tried to look at stuff and was never successful. In 2012, Tapper announced the Hermes card. They were going to sell the Hermes card. And it's a full duplex radio. You can run the transmitter and receiver simultaneously. And so I thought, that's a something that has digital input and output, and I record what it does, and I don't have TR switching issues. And I wonder if I could look at the ionosphere with something like Hermes. Fortunately, I went to DCC 2012, and there was a Sunday seminar by Tom Rondeau on GNU Radio. And I said, I don't have to write all of this stuff. I can just use GNU Radio to do all the processing. And so it saved a lot of time, and GNU Radio turned out to be of tremendous benefit. So I wrote a driver for Hermes and presented that a couple of years ago. And the experiments here were done using Hermes, using GNU Radio, and a little bit of Python. So a little bit of outline there. In radar, they have some kind of weird terminology, so I'll define it here. There's two general techniques for echoing or taking target measurements. One's called bistatic and one's called monostatic. Talk a little bit about the ionosphere, the modulation technique called chirp. And once we chirp something, how do we pull anything useful out of what we get back? That's done with signal processing. Talk a little bit about correlation, windowing, and post-processing, and have a diagram of the system, some measured results, and then further work. So bistatic versus monostatic. Bistatic basically means that the transmitter and receiver are at separate locations. So at the bottom of the diagram on the left, you can see that the transmit antenna transmits a signal up to the ionosphere. That signal is reflected. It comes back down to the receiver. And what you're actually measuring here is the midpoint of the path between the transmitter and receiver. So you're measuring the maximum usable frequency at the path midpoint. The transmitter and receiver need to share a common time frequency reference. So they both have to agree on frequency and they both have to agree on time. And the receiver only needs modest dynamic range, because hopefully you can put the receiver far enough away from the transmitter that the transmitter doesn't overload the receiver. Monostatic, on the other hand, means that the transmitter and receiver are co-located. And this measures the critical frequency, which is the frequency that the ionosphere will reflect a signal that's vertically incident straight back down. And the critical frequency is always lower than the maximum usable frequency. When the transmitter and receiver are co-located, they can share frequency and time reference pretty easily. On Hermes, they're on the same printed circuit card, so they share it very well. But one of the problems is that this receive antenna is very close to the transmit antenna, and so when you send a signal up to the ionosphere, what comes down is a really strong transmit signal and a really weak receive signal buried way down inside that transmit signal. So you need a receiver with very good dynamic range, and as it turns out, you need to do a little bit more work than that. So in monostatic, we're operating a full duplex, and the reflection delay off the F layer is about 1.6 milliseconds. So if you were to try and TR switch, you'd need PIN diodes, and even then, there would be issues. The transmit signal is much stronger than the receive echo because the transmit antenna will send a signal directly to the receive antenna, which in my case is about 20 meters away, and just completely overwhelm it. So you have to worry about receive overload, transmit and receive phase noise, the performance of the A to D converter on the receiver. And I found out that Hermes actually works quite well. In doing some initial experiments, I was able to transmit on 80 meters and while transmitting at 20 or 30 watts out, see received signals within a few hundred hertz of the carrier while transmitting. So that told me that module works well. Ultimately, I ended up buying an Alex filter module and connecting that to Hermes, and everything quit working. The issue here is the Alex can be set up to have a separate receive antenna from the transmit antenna. So it does work full duplex, but there's enough leakage in the relays on the module that the leakage through the relays would swamp the receiver. So I ended up uncabling the receiver part of Alex and going separately into the Hermes module, but leaving Alex in place for transmit because it provides the low-pass filtering. So the system has a Hermes module, a Munin amplifier, and the Alex filter, and it takes care of getting rid of the harmonics out of the transmit amplifier. Another thing we need to know is the precise transmit time. The system that I use is a Linux Core i7, and Hermes uses Ethernet to send packets, so you send Ethernet packets to the Hermes module from the processor, you get back Ethernet packets. And there's Ethernet packetization delay, the operating system's got some scheduling delays, and there's at times 2 or 3 milliseconds of delay. And so you have to compensate for that. If you're trying to measure a 1.6 millisecond reflection delay, 2 or 3 milliseconds in operating system delay is important. And then you need good frequency control because the Doppler shift of the ionosphere is in the neighborhood of a few tenths of a hertz. And so your oscillator needs to be stable. Fortunately, most crystal oscillators are stable easily, sufficiently for doing this kind of measurement. So let's look a little bit at the ionosphere. The critical frequency is the maximum frequency of reflection when you go straight up and come straight back down. The maximum usable frequency is the maximum frequency that can be reflected at an angle. And generally, the MUF is equal to the critical frequency divided by the sine of theta. And the reason for that is when you launch a signal at an angle, it basically can travel farther through the ionosphere before you get to the top side. So it's just strictly geometric. You launch at an angle and, you know, it's like sloped armor on a tank. You know, it's much thicker in one direction. And that increases the MUF. Now we have this E layer in the middle, and that's sort of like a big resistive attenuator. When we send signals up from the ground up through to the F layer, they get attenuated going through the E layer, they bounce off, they get attenuated a second time and come back. And so to make the measurements, we have to pick the time of day that we want to use. So the height of the F layer here causes the reflection time delay. So it takes about 800 microseconds for the signal to go up and another 800 microseconds for it to come down. So if we measure the time delay of the reflection, we can then compute the altitude of the F layer. Second thing is this F layer actually drifts upwards or drifts downwards. And that drifting causes Doppler shift on the signal that we're sending up and the signal that we receive down. In fact, it doubles the Doppler shift because it's moving and it receives a signal, so there's a Doppler shift. And then it's a moving signal reflecting the signal back, so there's a Doppler shift again. So it in fact gives you double the Doppler shift. During the day, this E layer is very heavily ionized. And on 80 meters, it pretty much absorbs all of the signal. And so during the daytime, you can't really make measurements on 80 meters. You have to wait till the evening when the sun sets. The E layer deionizes in about an hour and a half. And then that attenuator is gone, and all of a sudden you start to see reflections crop up. Now, during the day, you can the E layer, in fact, many times will reflect signals on 160 meters. Right now, I don't have the ability to put up an antenna for 160 that's efficient enough to radiate a signal straight up, so that'll have to wait to some later time. So this is, let's talk a little bit about the modulation approach. A chirp here, I took this diagram off the web, it basically shows a linear chirp. The amplitude is constant, and it sweeps in frequency from a low frequency up to a higher frequency, and that's called FMCW. Waveform. So what happens is if we transmit a chirp, that's this blue signal here, that signal goes up to the ionosphere and comes back down, and we receive it some time later, and that later time that we receive it is the propagation delay time up and back. And so if we know the exact time that the transmitter started and the exact frequency that it started at the receiver, we can say, well, we know that the transmitter was here, but we received this frequency here. We can then, by looking at the frequency difference, tell how much time delay elapsed between when the signal was transmitted and when we received it. Alternatively, if we could also measure the frequency offset. If we know the frequency that we expect the transmitter at and look and use a copy of the transmit signal as a local oscillator at the receiver, we can extract a frequency difference. So either way is an approach we can use to measure the time delay. Now, Doppler shift complicates things. If we look at the first case here, an up chirp, we go from a lower frequency to a higher frequency, and then we snap back and do it again. The dashed line is the signal we would receive if there were no Doppler shift. So it's just a time-delayed version of the transmit signal. But let's assume that the ionosphere is drifting downwards. That will cause a positive Doppler shift. And so what we really receive, the red signal here, has been shifted up in frequency by the amount of the Doppler shift. And so that shift up in frequency here causes a range error due to the Doppler shift. So we will receive, we will interpret that we got the signal earlier than we should have because we think we know when the transmitter transmitted it, we think we know the transmitter's frequency, and that gets distorted by the Doppler shift. So we get a positive range error. Conversely, when we transmit a down chirp, that same falling ionosphere causes positive Doppler shift. But in this case, the error that it causes is opposite in sign to the range error we got when we used the up chirp. And that's extremely convenient, and we'll make use of that. So now we have the problem of we have a transmit signal of 6 watts, and we're trying to look at a received signal that's 70, 80, 90 dB down from that. And essentially, it's buried in noise. So how do we pull the receive signal that we're looking for out of that mess of transmit signal plus receive signal all jumbled together. And the approach is that we correlate the received signal against a replica of the transmitted signal. That's called a matched filter. And this gives us a couple of advantages. Number one is that we can actually see the time of the transmit signal. We'll get a very strong correlation peak at the time of the transmit signal. And therefore, we know after we go through all the Ethernets and the operating system schedulers and all the local delays, we'll see the transmit signal, and so we know that that's happening after all of those processing delays. Then we get a weak peak due to the received echo, and so what we measure is the difference in time between the transmit peak and the receive peak. By doing that, we're able to subtract out the errors in the test setup and find just the actual time delay of the RF propagation and not the time delay going through an Ethernet switch or something else. Now, the peak is pretty weak, and we also want to try and resolve in time as accurately as possible where that peak is. And so it takes a lot of taps in the filter in order to do it. Currently, I'm using a filter that's got 1 million taps. And that's needed at the receive sample rate of 384 kilosamples per second in order to get about a 5 kilometer range bucket. So I can resolve the height to within about 5 kilometers using that many taps. A lot of taps gives good dynamic range. It gives really good time resolution. And then we can run a couple of chirps. We can record a couple of chirps. And then we can integrate those receive signals, and that will cause the noise to decrease and the actual receive signals to stay about the same. So we'll improve the signal-to-noise ratio is about the square root of the number of chirps that we look at. Now, the way that we do this is we use what's called an FIR filter. It's a big delay line that you put the receive signal in and you multiply each received sample in time against a tap which has got a copy of the transmitted signal in it. The problem is that FIR filters require about n squared computations. So if we put 1 million samples in an FIR filter, we have to compute about 10 to the 12th samples on the receiver. And I've got a really fast computer, and it completely chokes on something like that. So what we're trying to do is a match filter or a correlator is we take the time-reversed transmit sequence. We use those as the taps to the filter, and we put in the receive signal into the filter, and it sample by sample clocks its way through the filter. We time reverse the transmit because we can take a snippet of a single transmit chirp. Offline, we can do a time reverse, and then when we start up the flow graph, we can just load that file in, and we don't have to worry about buffering receive samples. They just get clocked into the FIR. So the way that we solve this problem is that we actually do the filtering in the frequency domain rather than in the time domain. And it turns out that this takes on the order of about 10 to the 7th computations rather than 10 to the 12th. So it's a factor of about 100,000 faster to do it in the frequency domain. The reason is we do a fast Fourier transform of the signals that we receive. We do a fast Fourier transmit of the transmit replica signal, and then we pairwise multiply those one per sample set, so that's 1 million multiplies or complex multiplies, and then we do an inverse Fourier transform to get it back to something in the time domain. FFTs are incredibly efficient, and so they're almost, not quite, but almost zero cost computationally. And so we use them, the FFT is on the order of about n log n, and so the multiplies, there's about 10 times as many operations in the FFT as one pass through the frequency multiply. But it's still 100,000 times more efficient than trying to do it in the time domain. So this is a block diagram of the test setup. The blocks in pink are GNU radio software. The blocks in light blue are hardware, and the block in pink is a Python post-processing program. So this block is a chirp source. Now, there wasn't a chirp source in GNU radio, so I wrote one in Python. And it turns out that there are some tricks in Python that will let you do stuff very fast. And the way that this is done is, when I start the flow graph, the init routine builds the buffer for the chirp. And then at runtime, in the init routine, it puts it into what's called a NumPy array. A NumPy array is a special Python array, which is very inflexible, but its syntax is essentially, it's a C array, and it has indices and time. And so GNU radio is able to clock out the samples. Once the buffer's been built, periodically just go clock samples out of that array. And that's an extremely efficient process. So when you can write blocks in Python, they're quick to write, quick to debug. So we transmit chirp out of this waveform. So it transmits from about 20 kilohertz below the channel center frequency up through the channel center frequency to about 20 kilohertz above. And then it snaps back to 20 kilohertz below and chirps up again. Actually, there is a raised cosine ramp. So during that transition from high to low, it actually ramps the amplitude down to zero for a few milliseconds and then ramps it back up. And that prevents it from generating all kinds of wideband spectral noise. So it's much cleaner. That chirp is sent over the Ethernet to the Hermes transmitter. The Hermes transmitter sends that signal to the Munin power amplifier that goes through a bandpass filter, an antenna tuner, and up to a horizontal dipole. Now, I only have room for a 40-meter horizontal dipole, so it's fed with about 120 feet of ladder line, and on 80 meters, I get about 5 dB of loss in the ladder line. So I'm putting out 20 watts here, and I'm getting about 6 watts up at the transmit antenna. On the receive side, I built an active receive loop. It's about a 1 meter diameter receive loop. And it's powered up through a bias T, and that feeds the Hermes receiver, which is on the same circuit card as the Hermes transmitter. So while it's transmitting, it's receiving at the same frequency that it's transmitting at. The output of that receiver then goes over Ethernet and into a Linux box where GNU radio is running, and it takes those samples. It goes through a low-pass filter, and then goes through the correlator, which is this fast Fourier transform filter, and then the samples are sent to a disk file. The conjugate chirp, chirp is nice. Time reverse chirp and a conjugate chirp are the same thing. It's symmetrical, and so I use the up chirp signal to filter the down chirp, and I use the down chirp signal to filter the up chirp. And then after a data set's been collected, this Python program goes and analyzes the received data. The data files, for about 20, 25 seconds of transmission, the data files are on the order of 100 megabytes. So here's a picture of the first version of the test setup. You can see the Hermes module here. You can see the Munin power amplifier, the bias T, 12-volt DC power, and the antenna. This is the antenna, which is outside in the yard. It's about 20 meters away from the transmit antenna, which is the 40-meter dipole. Now, I built this one with two loops because at some time in the future, I want to be able to measure circular polarization. During this experiment, however, I only had a single receiver channel available, and so I'm only using one of these loops. I'm not using both of the loops. The loop is set to null the signal from the transmit dipole. The transmit dipole is horizontally polarized. This is vertically polarized. And so it A, nulls the transmit signal, and B, it nulls the local AM broadcast station, which is about a mile away when I can see out the backyard. There's also some AM broadcast suckout traps in the amplifier on this. The amplifier here is a differential amp, uses a pair of two N5109s, and then does a differential to single-ended conversion. And by doing it that way, and then goes through a common mode choke. And it preserves balance quite well and prevents common mode signals from getting into the antenna. It's also incredibly wide band. This loop runs from about 60 kilohertz up to around 25 megahertz. So it's pretty flat and doesn't require any tuning. So it's very convenient. You just hook it up and forget about it. Now, one of the problems that happens when you put a signal into an FFT is that you have to window the sample set that you put into the Fourier transform. If you put a, if you take an FFT of a sine wave that's not synchronous to the sampling time, you get what's called spectral leakage. And the spectral leakage happens because the samples, if you don't, the FFT thinks that the signal you're putting into it is periodic. And if it isn't really periodic, what the FFT sees is something with a big step transition in the middle of it, and it just smears out all of the resolution that you get. And the way that you solve that problem is that you amplitude filter the stuff at the ends of the FFT down in amplitude, and you leave the stuff in the middle up at high amplitude, and that windowing process filters out all of that noise, that spectral leakage that you get. That spectral leakage here is quite significant. It totally obscures the echo. And so the way that it's done is we window the received sequence in time. Since we're sending a transmit sequence that goes from 20 kilohertz below the channel frequency up through to 20 kilohertz above the channel frequency, if we use a low-pass filter here, the black line, it lets stuff near the channel center, that's zero, through, and stuff that's high in frequency, plus 20 kilohertz or minus 20 kilohertz, gets attenuated by that low-pass filter. And so as we sweep in time, we sweep through this filter, and the result is this blue thing here, which goes, starts at a low amplitude, goes up to maximum amplitude, and drops back down. And so a low-pass filter gives us time windowing. And the window function that I used here is what's called a Blackman-Harris window. A Blackman-Harris window has extremely good rejection of fairly close-in artifacts and smearing of the spectrum. It does widen out the main lobe somewhat. It makes it about 50% wider. So it's unusual that a low-pass filter is a time domain filter, but it's only because we're putting a chirp into it, and so what comes out is time domain windowed. So this graph shows the effect. This was done in simulation. One of the nice things about GNU Radio is I was able to simulate everything before actually having to transmit anything. I built a simulator where I could program the time delay, the Doppler shift, the noise, and turn all the knobs during simulation and look at what happens. And that let me design the appropriate windowing filters and those things to optimize the extraction. So the blue correlation signal is what happens if we don't window, and the red is the output after we use a Blackman-Harris low-pass filter. And you can see there's quite a bit of difference. So this is the transmit signal peak. And the Blackman-Harris window actually occurs later in time because there's time delay in the filter. And for this graph, I put a time delay in the unfiltered one so I could line them up and you could kind of compare them a little more easily. So here's the transmit signal, and you can see we have all of this smearing happening as a result of spectral leakage. And then in red here, you can see it falls way down. And it does so at about 600 or 700 microseconds after the transmit signal. So it pulls down all of those spectral artifacts enough that we can easily see the receive echo pop up out of those artifacts. This is the GNU Radio flow graph. GNU Radio, I'm running it on a Linux Core i7. And I can actually run multiple correlators at the same time in parallel if I want to. I typically only use one. It's a pretty simple flow graph. Here's the chirp source. It sends packets to the Hermes module at 48 kilosamples per second. And what comes out, Hermes, is at 384 kilosamples per second. I'd like to see a new version of Hermes with a faster transmit sample rate, because if it were available, I could improve the resolution of the algorithm. Here's the low-pass filter, the Blackman-Harris low-pass filter that does the time domain windowing. And here's the FFT filter that does the correlation. The line here, taps, tells it what the taps for the filter are, and it just points to a file on disk. So when you start up the flow graph, it reads, if you're doing an up chirp, it reads the down chirp taps and loads them into the filter when it starts up. Didn't have to write any of these blocks. They're all built into GNU Radio, so it made experimentation terrific. The output of the correlator is complex valued, so we extract the magnitude. So it's just I squared plus Q squared. We actually extract the magnitude squared. The magnitude, I could take the square root, but there's really no need to do that, because square root's very expensive computationally. And when I plot the log of it, instead of multiplying by 20, I just multiply by 10, and the factor of 2 just falls out. So by just changing the multiply factor in the log plotter, you avoid a lot of unnecessary computation. All of the blocks up here are basically parameters that set up the options for the flow graph, and they tell it, define the GUI. One of the variables here looks at the computer's real-time clock, and when you start a flow graph, it modifies the file name and puts the date and timestamp right in the file name, so that anytime you run it, you automatically get a new file without overwriting the old file. So it's got a lot of neat things like that in it. So post-processing. The disk file is very large. It's about 25 seconds worth of samples at 384K. The Python program reads the separate upchirp and downchirp files. So I transmit upchirp for about 25 seconds, turn it off and do a CWID, and then run the opposite chirp for about 25 seconds, and then turn it off and do the ID. So I get two separate files. I get an upchirp file, and I get a downchirp file. And each one's got about 10 sweeps in it. So the Python program goes through the file, and it finds that big transmit peak and says, OK, that's zero time. Whatever offset time it really happened to be, 4 milliseconds or whatever, it says we'll just call that zero. And then it looks through the waveform and tries to do a sanity check on the waveform. Sometimes the sweep number zero is always messed up, because the filter doesn't have any received samples in it yet, and so as those clock through, you get a bunch of garbage out. And it can look at that and know to throw that sweep out. Sometimes you'll get a static crash, which will mess up a receive sweep. So it's got a couple of quality checks, and it throws out the sweeps that aren't any good and keeps the remainder. And then it goes ahead and it does a non-coherent integration. All that means is it adds up, it finds a particular time bin, and it adds up all the samples and then divides by the number of sweeps. The reason that it's non-coherent is because of Doppler shift. The receive echo is actually drifting at about one-third of a hertz rate, and it's a complex number. And if you add up a complex number, it converges to zero, right? So you can't coherently integrate. You have to just look at how much energy is at that time. And if we could coherently integrate, it could improve the signal-to-noise ratio by another 3 dB. It could be possible to do that if we knew what the Doppler shift is. We could compensate for that and then coherently integrate and improve the performance. That's a really hard problem, so I'll leave that to some other time. So the plots. The Python program uses a library called matplotlib, which allows you to plot things in 2D or 3D. There's all kinds of visualization tools, and there's almost zero code to write it. Terrific. There's a GUI called Spider 2, which is a Python interactive development. I can't recommend it highly enough. It's free on Linux. There may be a Windows version, I don't know. It's nice in that if you don't know too much Python, like I didn't at the time, you just kind of hover on keywords and it'll pop up help and tell you what the arguments are. And so it's sort of got interactive help, and it's really convenient. So the results. Hermes module is really excellent performance. It's got very good close-in phase noise. The ADC works very well. I was able to achieve about 90 to 100 dB of post-correlator dynamic range. And the way I tested that is I put the transmitter into a dummy load and then looked at the output of the correlator, and it was about 100, sometimes 110 dB down from the transmit signal. So that's about the amount. With no transmit signal, I'm able to achieve about 120 dB range, and that is due to the fact that in GNU radio, we use single precision floating point, and that limits it to about 120 dB over a million taps. The result F layer echoes are easily seen. I'll show you a couple of slides here. Occasionally, I can see double transit echoes. Those are where signals go up to the ionosphere, come back to the ground, reflect off the ground, go back up, come back to the antenna a second time, and you can see those double transit echoes. And occasionally, I can resolve the ordinary wave and the extraordinary wave. So this is a sweep done at local noon on 3.6 megahertz. There is no F layer reflection because the E layer attenuation is extremely high at 3.6 megahertz. So you see this transmit signal here, and the color code, blue is the up chirp and green is the down chirp. And there are a couple of system artifacts. There's one at 4 milliseconds, which is extremely strong. I haven't figured out what causes that yet. And there's a couple of other artifacts in here, which you'll notice out in the F layer time frame, there's just noise. There's nothing out there. In the evening, this is a sweep done probably 8 or 9 in the evening. The E layer has deionized and is transparent at 3.6 megahertz. And here are the F layer echoes. And we can very clearly see the range error difference between the up chirp and the down chirp because we see two peaks here. We still have our spurious peak, and you notice that those aren't time shifted from each other. It's a spurious, there's no Doppler, and so they both line up in time. Here are those double transit echoes that you can see that are exactly twice the time delay and twice the range error because they're going through that process twice. So if we do the computation here, the splitting indicates that the Doppler shift was negative 0.38 hertz. And the height of the range, which is halfway in between the two, is 254 kilometers. And the vertical velocity of the ionosphere at that time computes to plus 15.4 meters per second. So it's drifting up at about 15 meters per second. So occasionally, it doesn't happen often, but I've seen it a few times, you will get double humps. And if you look at the peaks, you'll see two up chirp peaks and two down chirp peaks. And what is happening there is those two peaks are, one of them is the ordinary wave, and the other one is the extraordinary wave. What happens when you transmit a linearly polarized signal from an antenna? It's really the sum of a right-hand circular plus a left-hand circular signal coming off your antenna, but they are locked together. And the vector sum of those two is a linear polarization. When those signals get to the ionosphere is formed of ions and electrons. It's the electrons that do the work of refracting the signal. Electrons spin. And that spin is in the Earth's magnetic field, and so the spin precesses. What's the precessional frequency? Well, it's about 1.8 megahertz. It's an interesting number. So the electrons are spinning, and that causes the ionosphere to be what's called circularly birefringent. The speed of light is different for right-hand circular and left-hand circular. And now this linear polarized signal that goes into the ionosphere decouples into its two left-hand circular and right-hand circular components, and they travel at different velocity through the ionosphere. Now, if they go straight through and come out, they'll couple back together again. But because there's been a time delay, that linear polarization X will have rotated. That's called Faraday rotation, if you've heard that. That's what causes it. If the path geometry is fairly complex, the two signals will completely decouple and they'll propagate independently. And those two signals are called the ordinary wave and the extraordinary wave. On 80 meters and up, the X and the O both propagate very well in the ionosphere. At 160 meters, because the frequency is very close to the electron gyro resonance, the X wave doesn't propagate very well and it's quickly attenuated. And so that happens at 160, but for these measurements on 80 meters, I could ignore the attenuation of the X wave. So now we actually see the two X and O coming back down, and we can independently resolve those two signals. Now, one of the difficulties here is I don't know which is which. Because I'm using a linear receive antenna, it just sums the two circular signals and it can't tell them apart. It's one of the reasons that I built the crossed received loop is that by receiving both polarization axes, the GNU radio software could delay one by 90 degrees or the other and turn it into a circularly polarized receive antenna. And then I could figure out which polarization was which and from that determine which hump was X and which one was O. But that requires a two-channel coherent receiver. And right now, Hermes is a single channel. And so I don't yet have the ability to look at two phase coherent channels and add the delays. The nice thing about having two linear antennas is that you can take one, take the other, you can sum them. So you can look at various different linear polarizations. You can add them 90 degrees out of phase and look at right-hand or left-hand circular or do all of them at the same time. So it's a very powerful capability to have, and it's something I'd like to do in the future. So further work, E-layer measurements require a 160 meter transmit antenna of reasonable efficiency and match with a good zenith radiation pattern. That means that it radiates well straight up. My first attempt was a wire about 5 feet off the ground in an HOA restricted lot. And it didn't work too well. The 40-meter dipole, my antenna tuner will match to it, no problem. Unfortunately, I get about 0 watts out of the tuner. So I need a better antenna to emit a respectable signal on 160 meters. I'd like to identify the O wave and the X wave and figure out which is which. Need two receive antennas, two coherent receivers, and then at baseband, we can synthesize all of that. The nice thing about having I and Q samples is that changing the phase delay is trivially simple. You just multiply by a complex number and you change the phase and it's broadband. And when you have only real valued signals, it's a hard problem. And when you have complex signals, it's a really easy problem. So I'd like to give thanks to some folks who reviewed the article, Andrew Martin, John Petrich and Phil Harmon took a look at the manuscript and helped me with some comments, so I really appreciate their feedback. And we have time for a few questions.
Tom, very, very, very interesting. Thank you very much. I've got one question. Are governmental or other telecom authorities who run ionospheric sounding stations mm-hmm. around the world looking into this technique? Seems like a tremendous alternative to what they've been doing over the years.
Yeah, there have been a number of papers published on what are called bistatic measurements, where some of the sounding stations will transmit their chirps at exact, you know, at very pre-announced times and frequencies, and then all you need is a receiver to look at that, and you're able to find the MUF of the path from it. And there's been a fair amount of work done there, so there's a lot of excellent work.
Tom, Ward Silver in 0AX. A couple of questions. One is, I'm a big believer in easier to ask forgiveness than permission. Has anybody reviewed the use of frequency swept waveforms in the amateur bands? I think this is something very interesting that more guys should try. And the second question is, could this be applied at 50 megahertz to look for sporadic E phenomena in the E-layer by amateurs?
Yeah, on the first question, I reviewed part 97, and one of the parts says that amateurs may transmit in the amateur band. It doesn't list any restrictions at all for test purposes for brief periods of time, except that you can't transmit pulse or spread spectrum. There's another section that defines what spread spectrum is, and a spread spectrum requires information to be transmitted that is then spread. Non-signal carrying emissions like FMCW have the last suffix designator is N, and the FCC regulations specifically state N is not a spread spectrum signal by definition. So my reading and the reading of some other folks that I asked to look at it all say that you can do that.
And what about the 50 megahertz question?
50 megahertz? I don't know. In theory, it should work. I don't know what the reflection coefficient of the E layer will be at 50 megahertz. Here, you're trying to measure it straight up and straight down. And if there's sufficient reflected signal, in theory, you could make such a measurement. The antennas certainly are a lot easier. You could build Yagis that point up. So there's a lot of things you could do to get improved system gain between the transmitter and receiver.
Yeah, I was just wondering, you were referring to extraordinary waves
yes.
that occur occasionally. What's the frequency of the occurrence of those waves?
Well, that's at the same frequency that we're transmitting at. So these experiments were run around 3.6 megahertz. And so they're easily resolved. But there will be X and O propagation at all HF frequencies that get to the F layer. And you can clearly hear these on 20 meters, 15 meters, under special circumstances. And they cause a lot of selective fading because the path geometries are such that there's different time delay. And they'll constructively and destructively add, and you can see the nulls sweeping through the passband. So they affect all HF propagation.
So we got one more question.
Tom, I remember Phil was doing some experimentation with backscatter as opposed to like the receive and transmit frequencies measuring the layer in between the two stations. Mm-hmm. Would your techniques apply to that kind of propagation where you get a backscatter reflection back toward the transmitter?
It might. I haven't really looked at that to see what's involved in terms of signal levels, but if the difficulty with having a monostatic system, right, is you've got to have the receive signal's got to be strong enough that it comes up out of the transmitter noise floor. And so if the echoes are too faint, it's a problem. Then separating the transmitter and receiver by, you know, 10 miles or something like that really helps you out because it gets rid of a lot of that transmit noise. So separating things can give you a lot better receive sensitivity. I've never looked at it to see what the levels are like.
Thank you very much.
Okay, just in case you were confused like I was, Tom had referred to the E-layer absorbing signals. And I've always understood that that was the D-layer's job. That's what it does, and it does. But Tom assured me that he did mean the E-layer. That's what he was talking about. I need to talk to him sometime and get a good explanation about that. I did a little bit of web research, and I asked Google what it knew about the E-layer, and I only found the usual stuff about sporadic E and a bunch of math that went over my head real quick. So Tom, let's talk sometime about the E-layer. But that's what he meant. That's it for this episode. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. If you get something out of these programs, and these programs you pretty much should, stop by, click the pig, help me out. Costs a lot of money to get there and takes a lot of time to put them together. So here we go. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. Over and out.